Greetings, friends of typography. Variable fonts are open type fonts which give font users full control over certain design features like weight, slant, optical size, and so on. The technology was introduced and standardized in 2016, and now after a couple of years, there is already a sufficient software support among browsers and graphic design apps. And more fonts are released in this new font format. So if you haven't worked with the variable font technology before, now would be a good time to learn about it so you can consider it for upcoming design projects. And this video will tell you all you need to know about what variable fonts are and how they can be used. Variable fonts use an automatic interpolation of the letter forms. The type designer needs to create at least two compatible designs, and many steps in between those designs are then generated on the fly. This technology already existed in the 1990s. Apple had it as part of their TrueType GX system. Adobe had a similar technology for PostScript fonts called Multiple Master. But both technologies didn't really catch on. Type designers continued to use interpolation to create larger font families, but what they would ship to the user were selected individual fonts representing independent styles like regular, condensed, bold italic, and so on. So what changed? When similar technologies didn't catch on, why was there another attempt in the 21st century? First of all, unlike the font interpolation techniques of the 1990s, variable fonts were a joint effort of the major tech companies in the field. Apple, Microsoft, Google, and Adobe developed variable fonts together, and the technology was also added to the OpenType specifications. This almost guarantees a broad software support. Second, a new font use developed over time that didn't exist in this way in the 1990s. Web fonts. When fonts are embedded into websites, every kilobyte counts. Loading various independent fonts of a font family can significantly increase the loading time, and variable fonts can mitigate this problem. Now usually only one font needs to be loaded, and dozens of type styles can be generated from it on the fly. In addition, the font can even dynamically respond to certain parameters on the client's device. This allows for creative and experimental uses, but can also address typical problems like the many different screen aspect ratios people use to access web content. With a variable font, a wide screen could show a wide font for all headlines, and the smaller the screen gets, the more narrow the font becomes, all without needing to load multiple fonts. The design variations of a variable font are calculated and accessed along one axis or several axes. A variable font needs to have at least one to be a variable font. Five typical axes are included in the current OpenType specifications: weight, width, optical size, italic, and slant. But in addition to those standardized axes with an expected behavior, type designers can also choose to add any number of custom axes to their fonts. And their functionality is completely up to the type designer. This gives designers a lot of creative freedom, and many playful and experimental fonts have already been created since the introduction of this new format. The axes of a variable font don't even need to affect every character, and the design changes along an axis can be seamless or sudden. For example, one axis might seamlessly change the height of the crossbar in just a few uppercase letters which have a crossbar. Or one axis might switch a few letter forms from an upright design to a cursive design. While interpolating vector shapes is simple and straightforward, the technical implementation of variable fonts is rather sophisticated. Each glyph in a variable font is technically only stored once, just like in a conventional font. The other glyph designs used for interpolation are stored as mathematical variations of the base glyph. Type designers can also choose to add intermediate steps along the design axis. This avoids a typical problem of font interpolation. If only the masters like light and black are used for interpolation, the frequently used instances in the middle, like regular, cannot be controlled directly by the type designer. But variable fonts do not have this problem. Variable fonts also contain named instances. This means font users can easily access specific points along the design axis chosen by the type designer. So a variable font can still show bold, condensed, and other style options like in a conventional font family. The many steps along the design axis can be used, but it is by no means required. The named instances avoid that font users are overwhelmed by the many choices a variable font offers. You don't have to decide for yourself what you want to use as the regular style, for example. You will still be able to access what the type designer has suggested as regular. While the PostScript fonts of the 1980s and 90s were rather simple, OpenType already allows for lots of dynamic changes of outlines and metrics. Those are the so-called OpenType features. When font instances in a variable font are calculated on the fly, those changes need to be taken into account as well. So kerning values, for example, also need to be interpolated. Where required visually, variable fonts can also activate and deactivate ligatures at certain points along a design axis. The complexity of all those calculations does make the implementation of the variable font technology quite challenging. Variable fonts are already supported in all major browsers on recent operating systems. So there is hardly any reason not to use them for websites if you can make good use of the new format. You can even add a conventional font as fallback solution. More and more design applications for desktop computers also gain support for variable fonts. For example, Photoshop, Illustrator, InDesign, CorelDRAW and Sketch. Licensing and installation don't differ much from conventional fonts. After all, variable fonts are regular OpenType fonts, just with added functionality. For most commercial fonts, conventional and variable fonts are offered next to each other or they are bundled together. This will still be required for a while, since variable fonts are not backwards compatible. To make use of the range of style options in the variable font, the operating systems and apps need to fully support the new format. It's also useful to mention that you are usually buying the entire family with a single variable font. You cannot save money by just picking a few styles from a larger family, since all styles are usually included in a single variable font. On reseller websites like MyFonts and FontSpring, you can just do a keyword search to find fonts in a new format. And the Google Font Directory has a filter to only show variable fonts. To get a better understanding of what variable fonts can do, check out websites such as AccessPraxis and vfonts.com. They present a selection of variable fonts with sliders to test out the on-the-fly instance generation. So those were the basics of variable fonts. If you want to learn more about the actual CSS code required to embed variable fonts into websites, head over to the Academy section of our website, where we go through that in detail. And we will keep this section updated and possibly extended where necessary. And that's it for this episode. Please like and subscribe if this was helpful to you. If you want to support the creation of free educational typography content like this, you can join our team of supporters over at Patreon, which also gives you access to exclusive articles, videos, and font downloads.